Well, hello, 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 and welcome once again to 25 O'Clock. I'm your host, Dan Drago. Thanks for listening. Thanks for being here. Thanks for joining me on the show here on 25 O'Clock, Philadelphia's longest-running music podcast. I think on the show this week, John Morrison. John Morrison from, well, from all kinds of things. He's got a great podcast called Serious Rap Shit. He's on WXPN as the host of the brand new program Culture Cypher Radio. He's a musician and a beat maker and a music writer. He's lots and lots of things, and we talk about all this stuff and more. So you definitely want to hang out for a few more minutes and listen to my conversation with John. That's what we call a tease. That's what we call a way to keep you listening in the broadcast world. We'll get to more about John in just a second. But first off, if you're new to the show, old to the show, medium to the show, you should check out 25oclockpod.com. That's our website. That's where you can get anything and everything involving the show. All the episodes for streaming, for downloading, they're all there. They're all free. Check out the Friends and Neighbors page. That's where I link anyone and everyone who's ever been on the show. So if you like who you hear and you want more info, you go to the Friends and Neighbors page at 25oclockpod.com and you click and you click and you click some more. Join the mailing list. Find us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, all that stuff. 25oclockpod.com. It's a website that I made. That's a good tagline, too. Anyway, let's talk about John. Like I said, John Morrison, musician, writer, radio personality, DJ, podcaster. I would just say all out, you know, he's an all right, all out cultural icon. Let's call him that. He's probably rolling his eyes right now, hearing that for the first time. Nah, that's you, John. You're a guy. You're a mover. You're a shaker. You're a guy who does things. You can check out his music at johnmorrison215.bandcamp.com. You can find his podcast, Serious Rap Shit, seriousrapshit.podbean.com, and Culture Cypher Radio, which is a hip-hop program on WXPN 88.5 here in Philadelphia, XPN.org, literally everywhere else. You go to XPN.org, click on the programs link, and there they are, right there. There they are. There he is, Culture Cypher Radio. Upcoming shows, November 1st and November 22nd on WXPN. Either listen on the radio if you're in the Philadelphia area or check them out at xpn.org. And if you go to the archives on xpn.org for Culture Cypher Radio, you can check out his first episode of Culture Cypher Radio back in September. Outstanding show. We talk about it a little bit. Find him on Twitter, John_Liberator on Twitter. You can keep up with his writings and all the things. He has a record out called Southwest Psychedelphia that he did a few years ago. You can find that on Spotify and iTunes and everywhere you get music. I think I covered it all. I think I did all the calls to action about all the thousands of things that John Morrison does. It was great to have him over. I'd never met him before, and I hooked up with him on the internet, and it was a great talk. So let's get to that talk. Here it is, me and John Morrison talking on 25 O'Clock.
Fire. I'm waiting for the day when we can do our podcast just at somebody else's studio.
Yeah, that day
is coming very soon.
Nice, nice. Yeah. Well, you did like a live thing at Radio Kismet, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And I know they've got their own studios in there too.
They do. They may be the spot where we're. That's to start off when we start doing guests, because we've never done a guest on our show.
You guys seem like, I've listened to bits and pieces, you guys seem like you're perfectly entertaining enough,
but yeah,
between the two of you.
It's he and I, you know what I mean? So, yeah, we just signed a deal with iHeartMedia.
Oh, nice.
And they kind of gave us a soft suggestion about guests. So I was like, all right, you know, y'all are paying us for this now. So yeah,
guests are nice. Yeah, as long as it makes sense. There's enough punk rock in me, and I'm sure it's in you too, where it's just like anytime anyone above you suggests a thing, you're just like,
Yeah.
Screw you, man. I'm doing it.
Yeah.
Just to
that impulse is definitely there. Absolutely.
That would be my immediate thing right there. Yeah, just to double down and be like, no guests. This,
the thing that kind of brought us around to it is a bit, he and I had kind of made that resolution that like once we had a deal, we would be open to doing guests.
Yeah. And once you got space too and all that, right. I mean,
I don't want to bring like fucking Tessa Thompson to my apartment.
Yeah.
To do the interview her in my living room.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? I look forward to the day when Josh and I could just sit, talk shit for an hour and a half, and then just
and
send,
then
send it to
it up.
Somebody.
It's your problem now, man.
And it's just, you know, they handle all the shit that they handle.
Well, that's great, though. Good for you, man. That's the dream right there.
I'm excited about it, man.
Yeah.
I didn't know when we started doing this, because Josh kind of comes out of the sports world, and he had a sports podcast years ago, and he was like pitching the idea, like, yo, just me and you talking hip hop, talking life. And at that time, I was working two jobs. I was DJing and writing.
Yeah.
And I was like, I'm not doing a fucking podcast with you, sit around talk with you for an hour.
We already do that anyway.
Right. So some stuff freed up in my life, and I was like, yeah, let's do it.
Yeah.
You know? But yeah, the thought of like being paid to do it never crossed my mind.
No, it's That perplexes people sometimes, like certain people in certain aspects of media. It just perplexes them when you're just like, nah, I'm good.
Yeah.
They're like, you don't want more? And you're just like, nah.
There's an assumption that you're always, if you're doing it,
that you must like want to make $1 million off it or something like that.
You're trying to get on,
Yeah, you just, that you want to be like Joe Rogan or something like that.
Right.
And like this, like, I can't imagine anything that I less want to be.
Don't be like Joe Rogan.
I mean, I wouldn't mind Joe Rogan's money. I wouldn't mind Joe Rogan's access to people, but I certainly don't want to be Joe Rogan.
Right.
There are times I'm sure Joe Rogan wakes up, doesn't want to be Joe Rogan. He's just like, what have I done?
Look in the mirror like, this again?
He's like,
do this shit?
Enough of this edgelord shit, man. I just want a farm.
Yeah.
You're from Philly. You're born and raised, right?
Yeah.
You're from Southwest?
No. I am from West Oak Lane.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Uptown.
Yep, uptown, yeah. I didn't know that was a term until Cam Candle told me what it was.
I didn't know Cam Candle was from uptown. I've been, a big fan of theirs for years, and I didn't know they were from uptown until I heard them on your show, and they talked about it.
Yeah, I know Brianna's from up there. I think Mark's from just like one, like some neighborhood adjacent of it or something like that. But it's all, And you, your brother was a, I read a bit about you. I stalked you online a little bit.
That's what you got to do.
It's called, some people call it stalking. I call it preparation.
Hell,
you know, we'll let the people decide.
They'll decide what it is. Yeah.
So, I did some reading. There's a great article on Medium that you did a few years back where you're interviewed. That's, because there's not a lot about people who write, because you do a lot of writing,
right.
But then who writes about people who
about writers,
do a lot of writing? But your brother was a huge part in sort of shaping you musically, right?
Yeah, absolutely. My older brother, Devin, he grew up in that era, like that first generation of kids that got hit with, hip hop.
They're like early 80s, mid 80s,
As a, cultural phenomenon spread now. He was like part of that first generation of kids that grew up in that. And he was also a producer, made beats. I grew up watching him with just drum machines, samplers. He taught me about, this is like the beat, and you sample the kick and the snare, and like he showed me like the early break beats, ultimate breaks and beats, all of that stuff. Like my foundation musically, he's responsible for it.
Yeah, And he was he was part of a group too, right?
Yeah, absolutely. He used to be in a group called the Devastating Four. This was like late 80s.
I love it when hip hop groups had to have the number of who was in them.
You gotta know
it. Yeah.
You gotta
how
know
many
the
are
members.
In there?
Come on. You know what I mean? Furious Five.
Yeah,
how many
be
people
like,
in it?
I didn't buy that record unless I know exactly the number of people involved.
Yeah, so they were like magnificent. You know what I mean? The front women were like,
there were three front women, three female MCs, right?
Yeah. Which was,
I imagine, I mean, even right now would be unheard. Well, the idea of a rap group now is less and less heard of.
Absolutely.
But for to all be women, like, it's, that's got to be, that had to have been something.
Yeah, absolutely. And our family, we used to go see them perform at shows and talent competitions and stuff like that. So, you know, I've been even thinking about Philly hip hop and how long I've been involved in it. I look back and I'm like, yo, I was going to rap shows when I was, you know, 7 years old.
Yeah. That's really something. Because, I mean, whenever people think of that era of hip hop, people always think of New York.
Oh, yeah.
And LA too, but it was everywhere. Anywhere there was a major city, you know, there was a hip hop scene, you know, Detroit, Chicago, you know, wherever you were. And you were there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just living out as a little 7 year old, just running around.
Little kid. Seeing hip hop.
At the time, it didn't seem like one thing or another, but like later you realize that, like, oh, you were there for some really, really cool stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was a big musical family, I imagine.
Not
necessarily as performers, but definitely as appreciators, I imagine.
Definitely appreciators, in a way, performers too. My mom sang opera.
Oh, wow.
As a kid, like as a teenager, she was like a classically trained singer. She didn't really sing much. Like, she never did it professionally or anything like that. But yeah, me, my mom, my brother, all into music. My father, not so much.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, he was an appreciator, though, I imagine, right?
I'm sure of it. Yeah. My mom used to tell me stories about how my mom and my dad were real into the band Mandrill.
Yeah.
You know, Mandrill is like funk, psychedelic, Latin kind of fusion thing. She said they would go, whenever Mandrill would come to town, they would go see Mandrill. So I knew my pop was like really into them.
Yeah, that's some wild stuff too. That's certainly not super accessible.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. And then, so you're learning to make beats with your brother. When did you start to realize that it was something you could do on your own?
I would say pretty early on. He taught me how to make music. But a lot of the teaching, it wasn't a super, from what I can recall, it was hands-on and then it was not hands-on. Because, like, producing hip-hop is very much so a solitary exercise. You know what I mean? It's not like, later when I went to school and I would meet kids who grew up in, like, the suburbs or in, like, whiter neighborhoods, their music was more social in the sense that, like, they joined bands and played together. I didn't play music with other people until very later, as, like, a teenager or whatever. So, yeah, it was something that was like, okay, this is how you work the machine. This is how, you know, you chop your kick, your snare, you chop, you know, a horn stab, you loop a bass line.
Yeah.
And this is how you put it together. Now go do it on your own.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So pretty early on in the game, I was like, oh, okay, yeah, this is something that I do myself.
Yeah. And this is all, I mean, a lot of this is pre-computers. And so you're using like 808s and you're using
hardware drum machines.
And you're using like Akai, like hard disk editors or like samplers or MPC samplers and things like that.
Yeah. Definitely samplers, little toy Casio keyboards to make stuff. Everything lives on tape.
Yeah.
That kind of thing. So
that was fun. I mean, and that's not dissimilar from the punk rock world either, at least from like, it's just sitting with a very rudimentary amount of gear, your knowledge, and you just sit and bang at your limitations there until you start to make something that starts to sound like something that you would actually want to hear.
Right.
And that's always got to be a fun moment where you're just like, oh, that was cool. I made a cool thing.
Yeah. There was, you know, even now when I sit down and make beats, the process is still similar, different tools. But emotionally, I get a feeling similar to what I got as a kid. And
you can feel it come together too, right?
Right. It's like a puzzle that you have to put together. And making beats then gave me a very similar, I would say, like, emotional sense that, like, playing did. You know what I mean? Like playing with toys or playing with, you know, whatever.
Plus creativity and imagination and all that. Yeah. No, it's got to be very similar to just the general general play of any kid at mm-hmm. that age, even if it's just like, you know, riding your bike around and like making up little stories for yourself, yeah. you know, or, you know, making beats.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
What were some of the groups and artists, like, as you were coming up as a young person, particularly Philly related, that like really, really drove you, or like that you saw and you said, like, that, I want to do that, or I want to be like mm-hmm. that?
Okay, so it obviously, like, it goes in phases. When I was a kid, I listened to essentially what my older brother listened to. So it was a lot of groups like Mantronics, Philly groups like Three Times Dope, Cool C, Steady B, all of that stuff, like the foundational 80s Philly hip hop, and the stuff from New York as well. Throughout the 90s, it was like a whole other.
Yeah.
Once I got to high school, so like, okay, so early on in hip hop, all hip hop was underground hip hop.
Yeah.
Right. A lot of those labels like Sugar Hill, Enjoy, all of that stuff, the early rap was all independently owned, a lot of them black owned record labels, small labels. Then throughout the later 80s, you know, it was kind of similar to punk, where like all of the major labels scooped in,
yeah.
and, you know, signed up all
it's
of
always
the
thing. It's just like, all right, groups. Thanks, kids. Good job. We'll take it from here.
At like 100%.
That's just how it is anywhere for any sort of interesting, dynamic, incredibly organic, artistic movement, be it hip hop or, you know, jazz or punk rock or yeah. weird visual art or film. At some point, as soon as enough people start to get involved, like, or get interested, there's yeah, yeah. always someone who pops up and been like, oh, you're making money with this now? Yeah. Oh, well, we can help you with that.
Yeah. Yeah. Let's make more money on this.
Why don't you
this?
Come on over here? Yeah,
absolutely.
You get like Russell Simmons type guys being like, yeah, why don't you come over here?
Although, I mean, Russell Simmons.
Yeah, well, I mean, but Def Jam was at one point just a tiny little nothing label, just yeah. like anything else.
Yeah, in a dorm room.
Yep. So, yeah. But you're coming up in Philly and you listen to all this stuff, and it's funny to look at it now, but like hip hop became more and more mainstream, like almost in like directly as we were getting older, like mm-hmm. you would see more and more of it. Cause I remember like a period in middle school, even early high school, where everyone had Nirvana and everyone had The Chronic. Like yeah. that was just,
yeah.
Yeah. That was in everyone's backpack or like in everyone's Walkman or mm-hmm. something like that. And then I think about it now where, and I joke about this to people all the time, I go, guitars are over. I'm like, no one's picking up guitar. No one's making guitar bands. I said, the most exciting stuff being made right now is by a kid in a bedroom.
Yeah.
And that's who's going to make the most interesting thing that we've ever heard. Like, mm-hmm. yeah, like guys in Animal Collective or something like that. And that's just one version of just a bunch of guys sitting around just like making loops. And,
right.
But it's just been funny to kind of like come up and then to become an older person and see it all continue to grow. Mm-hmm. I'm curious if you have any perspective on that at all. old guys talking about young people's music, you know?
What the next revolution is going to be.
That makes great tape.
Yeah, yeah. Specifically, you know, with being involved in music as a journalist, as I am, like my day to day is writing about music.
Yeah.
And there's so much of music media that's centered around, you know, trying to find the next thing. You know what I mean? If there's like three guys with a laptop in some city you've never heard of, then, you know, Fader or Complex or any of these like media outlets, they want to do a feature or a scene yeah. report. On
they want to like break it first. Yeah.
That's what it is. And it reminds me of the thing that happened with like Sub Pop in Seattle, you know, in the late 80s, early 90s, where they flew British journalists out from like Melody Maker, NME, yeah. and all of that. And they wrote this scene report on grunge in Seattle.
Yeah.
Everybody's trying to do that now and like replicating that yeah. formula. But I don't know. There's music there, and there's things happening, but I don't know if there are necessarily scenes
yeah.
where people are, you know, where journalists and media outlets are proclaiming there to be scenes.
Yeah, there was something worth writing about. Like, right. there was a thing that was sustaining itself and was going to exist one way or the other, whether or not these people wrote about it or not,
yeah.
and it was going to thrive within its own world. and be fine. The rest of us could never have heard about it, and it still would have probably
been his thing, yeah.
done, and those bands still would have existed, maybe not to the level that you and I would come to know them, but, you know, there would still have been a Pearl Jam. It just, you know, they wouldn't be selling, they might not have been selling out arenas today.
I wonder how much of that is like hype or if it's a real thing.
How much of it are they like going to find something that's truly exciting, and then how much of it are they trying to spin it to be like, oh, look, you've never heard of them. That itself makes it exciting. And you're like, maybe. I don't know.
So I, you know, growing up in music and seeing all of this stuff, it just I'm a little conflicted with the work that I do.
Well, because you grew up in Philly, you're going checking out these, you know, going to these hip hop shows with your brother that your brother was a part of, or that your people that your brother knew, and seeing this scene that existed completely within the realm of where you lived. But then you didn't turn on the radio and hear this stuff. I mean, maybe you heard it on like local radio, but you certainly weren't turning on MTV and seeing it, and hearing about it in national media. And you just kind of understood at that point. It was like, well, this is our, this is our hip hop scene.
It's a real lived thing.
Yeah, this is our thing. And you know, somewhere else, someone else probably has their lived thing.
Yeah.
The fact that now that everything is sort of universal, that we can access everything at any time, it's great. And then also the worst thing ever.
Yeah. I love the fact that.
Don't get me wrong. I love Spotify and YouTube. Man. Yeah, don't get me wrong.
I checked my mail yesterday, and a young man who's incredible beat maker from Tokyo sent me a tape.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. I love that
you exists, can do that. Yeah,
you know what I mean. But I do miss thinking about like the mid '90s, where hip hop, in particular, underground hip hop, was super local. You know what I mean? I used to call people and send them mail orders. Like, I heard about some 12-inch that some guy made in Ohio or L.A. or wherever, and I would call up and be like, yo, you know, I want a record. And they'd be like, all right, send me a money order. And I would send people money, and they would send me their 12-inch.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I miss that. The internet is cool because it makes things smaller. It makes the world smaller.
Yeah, and instant, you know, access, yeah.
Yeah, we have that access. But I do kind of miss... It's not even exclusivity. It's some other thing.
You would throw money, like, especially the time when you're a young person, you don't have any money. Like, you would throw your hard-earned money towards something that you had never heard. Like, you did not, you had only heard word of mouth. Or, I mean, for sometimes me growing up, it was like you'd see the cover of something. Or you'd hear someone like name check. Like, if when I was a teenager and I'd read, like, you know, spin articles of the bands that I knew, and they would name check some band you never heard of. And, like, me and my friends would be like, well, we got to go out. And
it's get, like, yo, you got to get there.
I remember, like, I was a big Breeders fan because, like, they were on the radio, and Kim Deal used to talk about this band called Guided by Voices all the time. And we're just like, she's like, oh, you got to check them out. They're from my hometown. They're the best band in the world, and we're, you know, all smitten with her. So we're just like, hey, we got to go listen to the band that Kim Deal told us to listen to,
and,
you know, and then but never heard it, you know, just going into a record store and being like, do you have Guided by Voices?
Kurt Cobain would drop, you know, the Raincoats,
or you wear that Flipper t-shirt or something like that on SNL. I just like, I don't know what Flipper is, I didn't know what Scratch Acid was, but because they talked about it, I had to go find it out, and and it was weird.
And it expanded your palate.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. And then if you bought it, like, you had to kind of, you had to live with it. You spent your money, man. Yeah. Like, this was your record. You had to listen to it. I remember getting, like Meat Puppets 2 or something like that second Meat Puppets record. Just simply because of the Nirvana endorsement and just being like, well, what's this hillbilly punk rock shit going on
it's
here?
It's got like some rockabilly shit happening.
Yeah, it's like country stuff. And at the time, it just, and at the, in the mid-90s, country was not cool.
No.
Not even
at all.
A little bit. It was, you know, pre-Brother Where Art Thou. Like, none of that shit was, none of that shit was cool again. Thank God. Made roots music cool again.
Oh, my God. You surprised me. I thought you were going to go somewhere else with that.
Yeah. I mean, there's other, I mean, I'm sure there are other things. Yeah, but at the time, like, country music was for like, your best friend's mom, like that's what she listened to in the car. Like, you didn't listen to country music or anything that sounded anything like that. But then you would hear like bands like Soul Asylum or the Jayhawks or something like that, and you'd be like, oh, I'm with you. I do miss that. So it was more immediate. It was more personal too. And then you'd trade, you know, tapes and CDs with people. You'd lend people tapes, and if you were lucky enough to have a you know, cassette deck with two decks. You could dub it.
Yeah, yeah.
Get it back to him the next morning.
Well, the remix tape that I've been working on mm-hmm. is finished, and I'm pressing up like official cassettes, like a very limited run of cassettes. But whenever I release something, I try to open up space to do custom cassettes for people.
Yeah.
So when I put out Southwest Psychedelphia, I went on the internet and I told people, I was like, all right, so if you buy Southwest Psychedelphia and you ask me and you come to my house, I'll make you a custom, not even a version of the album, but a whole other tape, like a mystery tape.
Oh, of just like other stuff that you had
random
kicking around.
Shit.
Yeah.
A random shit. A homie of mine, have you heard the band Pinkwash?
I don't think so, no.
The incredible band, two-piece, like, post-hardcore band. My homegirl Ashley plays drums in that band. And right after Southwest Psychedelphia came out, she hit me up and was like, yo, can you make me a tape? And I made her just, like, the wildest mystery tape. Some of it is, like, me just jamming, you know, making music. Some of it is, like, songs that I never put out that I've recorded over the years. Some of it, I'll just have like a pile of records next to the turntable, and I'll just make a mix of just crazy
shit.
Yeah,
just like whatever's sitting right there.
So yeah. I gave a few people that to kind of, in my mind, it's kind of like, okay, years ago, the band Olivia Tremor Control put out a
record.
I'm a
big fan, yeah.
I love Olivia Tremor Control and the whole Elephant Six.
Yeah.
They put out a record, and there was a rumor, I still don't know if this is true, that there's like a weird ambient tape version of that record that you can get that goes along with it. I think it was the album Dusk at Cuba's Castle.
Yeah, yeah.
There was like a mystery version of that album.
Oh, weird. I didn't know that. That's...
I try to make shit like that. You know what I mean? Where it's like, okay, you bought this official piece of art that
now
I
here's
made.
Like the weird companion piece.
Come on.
Yeah.
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 That's exactly.
No, that's great. Yeah. And that's sort of, that's like sort of anti how you're supposed to do things. You're not supposed to give people like way more. You're supposed to make people focus on like one thing, like one single or one like, you know, couple of songs.
I'm trying to balance
that. Well, no, but I like the idea because, I mean, you and I know a ton of creative people, and most of the creative people we know are insanely prolific. Like, they're just constantly making something. That's like sort of the core of being a creative person. You're constantly making something, and whether or not you put that something out in the world or not is a whole other thing, but it's always there. You and I know a lot of people who have a lot of hard drives just full of stuff.
Yeah.
So I think it's cool sometimes where you can kind of like turn over parts of it or just kind of like almost like play roulette with it and just be like, and these ones, here you go.
All of it is giving out imagination, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Sometimes you sell it, sometimes you give it away for free. I want people to hear and feel what play feels like to me and what imagination feels like.
Yeah, no, absolutely. That's a really, really great way to put it. And I know you're a crate digger, but I'm always curious because everyone's got different approaches. I'm curious, what's your approach to crate digging? Do you have a system? Do you have a do you have little tricks and stuff? Or like when, because it can be super overwhelming to like someone throw you in a basement of some shop somewhere that's just full of vinyl, and you're just like, well, do I waste an afternoon? Like, how do you dive in?
Primarily what I sometimes spin records.
Yeah.
But because the primary function of me buying records is to make beats and chop them up and sample them, a lot of how I interact with music is based on timbre and like the actual sounds that are on a record.
Yeah.
So a lot of times I'm just looking for Rhodes piano, or I'm just looking for I don't know, like an ARP 2600, or I'm just looking for specific drum breaks. You know what I mean? So even it's weird because it's a kind of strange way of like atomizing music. That's really how I approach it. So a lot of times when I'm crate digging, and somebody, you know, the guy behind the counter will be like, oh, what are you looking for? I'm like, I don't know, I'm looking for vibraphones. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, you know, or sometimes it'll be, I'll step back and I'll, in a macro sense, be obsessed with specific genres.
Yeah.
Or specific styles of music. You know what I mean? I'm always looking for psych shit.
Yeah.
Always looking for weird electronic shit.
Yeah.
Always looking for soul. You know what I mean? So funky stuff with like drum breaks, hard rock records from like the late 60s through to like the mid to late 70s with like open drum breaks, always looking for shit. Like lately I've been grabbing a lot of rock records with whole band, you know, white dudes, long hair, yeah, but there's drum breaks on. Heavy, open,
yeah,
rock drum breaks.
Yeah,
you know,
like,
I mean?
like Zeppelin type stuff. And that.
Right,
yeah,
right. I bought a Styx record.
That early Styx stuff is pretty great, though.
Listen,
like, I know we all think of them later as like the weird synthy roboto band, but like, right, they were an art band.
It's crazy. One of their records, I can't think of the name of it, but it has like three women's faces on the cover. And I bought a copy of it, and I said to my partner was with me, and I said to her, I was like, I know I have four other copies of this, but there's a drum break on it that's like ridiculously heavy, so I'm gonna buy another copy. You know what I mean? So it depends, and it's all, a lot of it is intuition, a lot of it is, you know, buying records since I was a child and knowing the session players, mm-hmm, knowing the engineers, the producers, and having that kind of,
yeah,
mental Rolodex of,
like,
music.
Knowing a record label from a certain era and knowing just the general sound of the general types of artists that they would have on.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, and then it helps as, you know, as you're a music writer and you gain more and more knowledge, it just makes you a better crate digger.
Right.
Yeah.
It's that all of the stuff is, you know, the beat making,
yeah,
crate digging, DJing, and the writing, all of it is one ball of shit. It's tied together.
Yeah, yeah. No, I say the same thing about like playing out when I did, and the podcast and writing and generally like helping people do shows. I'm like, it's all just one big giant distraction,
yeah,
for me, so that I don't realize that we're all gonna die.
Oh my god. You know how you go in a record store and they have the listening stations?
Yeah.
I very rarely use those.
Oh, you just all on
go
gut.
Off, yeah, intuition. I go off intuition. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Because a lot of that gamble is a part of it. You know what I mean? If I buy a record and then it sounds terrible, but it suits, you know, the sampling purposes that I need it,
the aesthetic,
and I turn
there,
it,
yeah,
into something, yeah, great, then it's like even more of like that emotional payoff. That,
yeah, yeah. It didn't come easy.
Yeah,
yeah.
You will not see me. You can see me. I'll go to, you know, a record shop and I'll listen to a single record. Or if, you know, one of like my DJ homies or somebody I know who works there hands me something and says, hey, listen to this, I'll listen. You will not see me at a record store with a stack of records,
yeah,
for 30 minutes at a listening station.
Yeah, yeah.
Don't do it. When I was younger, probably early 20s, I had a whole room in my apartment that was just gear and records. And I was going out every other day buying stacks of records wherever I could go.
Yeah. And they're cheaper then too. It was just, you could just,
on,
yeah, you could go, yeah, into these, like, go into thrift stores or flea markets or whatever and just dig and, yeah, find like weird Herb Alpert records and,
yeah,
you know.
It was before the, you know, the vinyl
before the
resurgence.
Vinyl craze, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, I have records. So funny story, a friend of mine does a monthly event at Brewery Town Beats. It's called Vinyl Tap.
Yeah.
DJs come, non-DJs come,
yeah,
you bring records and you spin. I'm spinning, I'm like pulling out breaks and just spinning like different,
yeah,
breaks. And I pulled out, it's a record by Johnny Jenkins. You know the Beck song Loser?
Yeah.
The drum break that they sampled for Loser is from a Johnny Jenkins record. So that's like a grail record, as,
yeah,
they call it.
If you play that drum beat, people are going to recognize it.
Everybody knows that,
yeah,
drum break. They'll know, oh, it's Beck, Loser.
Yeah.
So I pulled out that break and I played it, and a gentleman who was a collector, I can't think of his name, but he's from the UK, he happened to be in the shop, and he ran over to the turntables. He was like, yo, where'd you get that record? I was like, dog, I bought this when I was 16 for like a quarter at a thrift store in Germantown. I remember the day as clear as day, and I remember dropping the needle on the record and being like, oh, shit, that's Beck.
Yeah.
That's where he got that break from.
I love still getting that in music now, too, where like something came on my Spotify today, and I kind of look up, and I'm like, is this Slim Shady? And then I'm like, no, it's The Bed. And that it had never occurred to me that was something else. And then I had to pull my phone down and just be like, who is this? Mm-hmm. Like, I can't remember who it was now. But it was that, like, it had the little had the little guitar flourish in there, mm-hmm. and everything, just like from the song that you and I have heard, you know, a billion trillion times. But in that moment I was just like, oh yeah, everything is something else.
On Where Is That, when we started talking in this interview, I mentioned Mantronics, which was like, my brother saw Mantronics live, and he had the TR-808 on stage. He was like doing live beats on stage, and this was like 87.
Yeah,
that inspired my brother to make music. Beck's Where It's At, where the little vocoder drops in, like, I got two turntables and a microphone.
Yeah.
That's from Mantronics.
Oh, wow.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's like that record that Beck and the Dust Brothers made is made up of little pieces like that.
Yeah, they were crate diggers, too. Again, like when you said like that, you're not looking for necessarily a particular artist or a particular song, but you're looking for a timbre or an instrument sound or a particular mood. When you go about collecting that way, the disparate elements that you start to bring together it's got to be really something.
It's interesting to work that way. I try to remind myself to remember to like actually listen and enjoy songs.
It's like Questlove said in his book. He said he had to get to a point where he had to remember that like James Brown records didn't just exist to be cut up for breakbeats. That like, oh yeah, I had to remember that it was music.
Yeah,
and not just fodder.
Right. That resonates with me a lot.
You know
what I mean? Because I grew up in this. Like, I've been conditioned this way. To hear music. I
and just take it apart. What other kind of things in your life kind of like set you forth? Because you have a voracious musical appetite, and you have an incredibly large knowledge base just from the little bit we've known each other on Facebook, and I see all that stuff you drop, which I have to tell you, I delight in constantly. I click on your shit probably more than I click on anyone else's, because nine times out of ten, I don't know what it is. And that's where I'm getting as a music listener and as a music-minded person, is just like, I'm like, if I've never heard of it, but someone I know who I know knows what they're talking about has heard of it, getting back to that old way of that's how you got turned on to new stuff.
I have areas that I'm strong in.
Yeah.
Because I know folks that are into like electronic dance music, people who, I know a little bit about house music, particularly like Detroit techno and Chicago house music and all of that kind of stuff. But I know folks whose knowledge is like super deep on that. But I also think that with me personally, hip hop, like every producer I know who's, 30 and up, hip hop producer, knows funk, knows soul, knows jazz really deep, knows psychedelic rock, knows prog rock.
Do you think that's from the crate digs? That's from the crate digs.
1,000%.
Yeah, because you're constantly,
1,000%.
Because if you're just looking for drum breaks, if that's how you approach records, it's like, I want drum breaks. And like,
I need 2, 4, 8 bars of open drums.
Yeah.
That can be anything. Bambada used to play the Monkees at Bronx Jams, and then play Can, and then play Kraftwerk.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? None of that should make any sense. But it makes perfect sense. You could go out, we could set up speakers outside this house right now, and I could play a set of like Africa Bambada, the Death Mix that came out years ago. He's playing Yellow Magic Orchestra, some Japanese electronic music next to Rick James or whatever.
Yeah.
I could play that same Death Mix set that Bambada did in the early 80s, and everybody who knows hip-hop would be like, oh, yeah, that's hip-hop.
Yeah.
But none of it is actually hip hop. You know what
That's
I mean?
That's the joy of it. It's just, it's these disparate elements that were just, that were there because of the lack of access to the traditional, the traditional way that you would go about creating music.
Yeah.
I did want to talk about the radio show, about Culture Cypher Radio, which, as of this point, you've done one. What I like about the show is that you've got this remarkable mouthpiece now that you can sort of, and this is not to blow smoke, but you have enough to say. You're worthy of that mouthpiece. Like, you have a large enough, you have a large enough taste and a large enough camp to pull from to make it interesting. Because it's one thing just to have, like, they could have had any kind of hip-hop show at any point if they'd ever decided to do it.
Right.
But your particular brand right there, I like how you got the hours structured out. So, like, hour one's kind of just sort of a straight hip-hop set.
Yeah, yeah. Kind of easy into
it.
Yeah.
Hour two, it's like you're playing around a little bit. And hour three is just like, all right, if you're still here.
Chaos hour, yeah.
I love that you played that Massive Attack.
The Pirate Radio.
Yeah, the Pirate Radio thing.
Yeah.
I'm a huge Massive Attack fan.
Yeah.
So to hear that too, I was just, and all I could think was like, where the hell did he find this?
Yeah, I wanted to, one, I wanted to do it live. You know what I mean? I wanted folks to know, like, okay, he's in the studio doing this right now.
How much of it was planned, and then how much of it did you sort of call audibles on as you were doing it that first time?
Planned a lot and called audibles as we went.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, yeah, I just, you know, I grew up on radio. I grew up on, like, FM radio, late night mix shows, underground hip-hop mix shows, and but also college radio with, like, indie rock stuff and, like, weird electronic shit.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I wanted to make a show that I would have wanted to listen to when I was 14, 15.
Yeah, that you would have dialed into, like, 10 o'clock at night or something like that when you're supposed to be asleep, and that's when you hear, you hear something like Can or something like that for
the
first
time. Like, yo, what is this? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And at an age, too, and hopefully it still exists in younger people, is that you can still, the mind is still there to be blown, like, even though, I mean, you know, even though we have access, there's just access to everything, like, you know, we got YouTube and our phone, I've seemingly the entire canon of Western recorded music, like, that I can pull up at any given moment, but it's nice to be able to know that you can, like, just catch people off guard. It's an excellent show.
Thank you.
I look forward to more of them.
I make my living in music. You know what I mean? I don't work a 9-to-5 anymore.
Oh, good for you, man.
Haven't in years. And, you know, I write for a living all day. I DJ, you know, and now this podcast thing that we're doing.
Yeah.
So everything, you know, this is how I make my living. But I wonder if what I'm doing, not even just like the, oh, am I selling out, man? Like, not that kind of thing. I just wonder, how much what I do is aiding in kind of taming this rebellious music.
It takes
that I love.
It takes the teeth out of it. Defanged is the term I think of sometimes.
It's interesting that you brought that up. I've heard some, like, older DC punks. On one hand, DC punks, but then on the other hand, black folks who grew up in DC. Folks who have grown up in, like on DC go-go music.
Oh, yeah,
remember, there was this whole controversy a few months ago about, there was, like, a Metro PCS or, like, a T-Mobile store playing DC go-go.
Yeah,
and the
like Trouble Funk or whatever, yeah.
Yeah, the gentrifiers were kind of, like, calling the cops because of complaining about the noise. And they had these huge protests. Black folks were coming out. The bands were coming out. And they were
like,
no.
Yeah, it's like, keep DC go-go or something like that.
This is our culture. Yeah. Like, you can't have it. And it was interesting to see a lot of the DC punks talk about just how gentrification and capitalism have kind of co-opted DC's punk history.
Yeah.
And you know, like, where you have punk cafes now.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it's like you have go-go, which is still resistance because black folks are marginalized in general. It's just, so yeah, it's interesting to me to see how punk has been kind of used, you know, and like you said, like defanged and used, you know, in service of capitalism.
It's a haircut and a jacket choice now.
Yeah, yeah. It's crazy. I remember throughout my 20s, in addition to like hip hop, I kind of moved in Philly's like psych rock and like noise scene.
Yeah.
I played in bands and all of that. But I remember meeting musicians and they were talking about like, oh yeah, we're going to move to Brooklyn.
Yeah. Many opportunities to leave or go or, you know, figure something else out. And you're just like, no. I don't
fault folks for leaving.
No, I don't fault anyone who does anything here for a reason. Yeah. Or even back when it seemed like nothing was going on here and you would leave. Yeah. I mean, I left where I was from.
Right.
And now there's stuff going on there. And I look at it, I'm like, oh, I wish that was cool when
where
I
from?
Rochester, New York.
Ah, okay.
Yeah. That whole, you know, that whole Rust Belt area been enjoying a bit of a renaissance over the last decade, just like any city.
Yeah.
Because any place that you can live cheaply, have access to some infrastructure, and like be around people who are like trying to make a thing, then, you know, young people and creative people are going to flock there, just like, you know, the Village in the 60s and the Lower East Side in the 70s and Brooklyn in 2002.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, for someone like you who's like, you know, and who moved between scenes, scenes that I imagine at the time had almost nothing to do with each other.
No overlap.
Yeah. There's a Venn diagram that was two circles on the other side of the room from each other.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Which is a shame. And nowadays, thankfully, you see a little more overlap of people. Yeah. I would hope so. I think because it's all more accessible and it's all more out there.
I was going to say, I think that with, I know younger folks that I meet, their tastes are way broader, way more eclectic. When I was a kid, like I went to high school in the mid-90s, and we legitimately had like goth kids and ska kids and kids who were into mainstream rap like Nas and Biggie and Jay-Z, and then kids who were into Company Flow and Freestyle Fellowship and like all the weird underground rap. And it was like a very you know, balkanized, like kind of.
Yeah, everyone had a tribe. You had a tribe.
Yeah, absolutely. Everybody now just has a bunch of shit on Spotify playlists, so it all mixes in together.
Yeah, it's all about if you show someone the right thing at the right time, you could ruin their lives forever.
They'll decide to be a musician.
Yep. Oh, God, don't do that.
Oh, man.
Yeah, yeah. Well, yeah, you look forward to doing this kind of thing guest-wise on your podcast.
Yeah. Yeah.
Congrats on getting over 100 episodes too. Like that's, dude. When I cracked 100, I was just, which wasn't really that long ago either.
Yeah,
I was just like, I've never made 100 of anything.
Right. It shocked me that Josh and I had stuck to this.
Yeah.
This long.
Because when you first start out, you're just like, I guess I'll do this until I don't do it anymore.
Right.
And like I thought to my, when I first started, I think I wanted to do like, I said, if I can get 25 or 30, I'll be happy, you know? And then one day I looked up and I was like 70, 80 in. And I was just like,
right.
Oh, I think this is what I do right now. And then the stubbornness kicks in. We're just like, well, can't stop now.
Got to do it. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
We have folks listen to us and keep us accountable.
Well, that's
well.
Good.
Yeah. Because, like, Josh and I miss a lot of weeks.
Well, yeah, yeah.
We like doing a bunch of shit, you know what I mean?
Well, it's hard. Yeah, you get a full-time job and all that.
Yeah.
And, like, and to do something that you guys do, it takes time. You got to sit in the room and do it together.
Right.
And then you got to pare it down to something that people might actually want to listen to.
Right.
Which is always fun.
Yeah. So, yeah, whenever we miss a week, folks, my older brother, he hits me up. He's like, yo, like,
where's
the episode?
Wait, what, are you done?
Yeah. People text me and they're like, yo, where's the show?
Yeah, you're just like, everyone settle down.
Yeah, yeah. I'm working on a remix tape that's coming out probably first week in November, and it's called Memorabilia. The artwork is a bunch of shit from like my childhood.
Yeah.
Like, Tower Records bags, like the big yellow bags, cassette tapes, records, all thrown out on the floor, and it's like an aerial shot from above of this pile of memories.
Yeah, well, because that's what it is sometimes. That's sort of like, if you want to get metaphorical on the memorabilia, it's just this pile of seemingly like useless junk or just like just stuff until you start to look more closely at it and you realize and then you see like you see the copy of Loveless or you see you see the Tower Records bag or you see the but that's exactly it right there. It looks like junk, but in the end, like that's, I don't know, man. That's a life.
we assign meaning to it. So
yeah, awesome. Yeah. Well, dude, thanks so much for coming.
Thank you for having me, man.
Hey,
this
man, this is great.
Yeah.
Well, that's the show for the week. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you, John Morrison, for coming over on an evening and chatting. Check out his music, johnmorrison215.bandcamp.com. Check out the Serious Rap Shit podcast, seriousrapshit.podbean.com. Culture Cypher Radio, coming November 1st and November 22nd. Go to xpn.org for more information about that. And like he says at the end, he's working on a remix tape. Should be out very, very soon. It's called Memorabilia. Watch for it. Follow him on Twitter, John_Liberator at Twitter. Do all the things. Great talk. Great dude. I had a great time. That's going to do it. That's the show. I don't have anything. I don't have anything weird to wax philosophical on this week. It's just one of those weeks you just try to keep your head down and just get it done. But yeah, I hope you enjoyed the show. I did. I enjoyed making the show. I'm done. I'm just spinning wheels now. This is stupid. Thanks for listening to the show. This has been 25 O'Clock, Philadelphia's longest running music podcast, I think. My name is Dan Drago. Until next time, take care of yourselves.